I want to convince you that you can approximate the future. And to do that, for those of you that don't know, in quantum physics, there's a long history of cats being involved. And the cats are always threatened, but never harmed. And in that spirit today, I'm going to use cats to conduct my experiments for me. And so I place a cat, and I give the cat a ball, and I ask the cat to throw the ball up against the wall. And then I ask the audience, that's you, to make a prediction of what exactly is going to happen. And this isn't a prediction you have to make out loud. You can keep it to yourself. And what you're going to do when that cat throws the ball is you're going to think, well, the ball does not have enough energy to penetrate the wall, and therefore the ball bounces back at the cat, which is exactly what it does. But the point's not that. The point is that we correctly approximated the future event. And we can use physics to make much better predictions of the future. And in fact, I'll show you next that when we replace that ball with a quantum particle, an atom or a molecule, that your guessing will no longer predict the future. Now, one of several peculiar features of quantum physics is the fact that if you look at it, the act of observation tampers with it, and it therefore alters the outcome. So part of every quantum experiment is actually to learn how to not look at the system. You can look at it, but it'll change it. It'll change it such that it does exactly what we anticipate in the classical world. So in that vein, I place a blindfold over Schrodinger's cat here as not to modify the outcomes. And once again, now I ask the cat to throw that quantum ball, and what's going to happen? So the ball will bounce back to the cat, but it'll do something else. The ball bounces back to the cat and also through the wall. The act of the ball going through the wall is referred to as quantum tunneling, and that's peculiar. The fact is, I didn't say it does one or the other with some probability. I said it does both, concurrently, simultaneously, and that's called quantum nonlocality, and that's very strange. Very strange. And so perhaps some of you will protest again, because I did tell you that this is the physics of our world. Quantum theory is the physics of our world. Why then does this seem so peculiar? And the reason this seems so peculiar is actually encapsulated in the blindfold on that cat. You see, when you look at quantum physics, it changes. And actually, quantum particles interacting are the same as making observations. And so it is through the interaction of quantum particles with each other that the world as we know it emerges. And although the world around us is a result of particles interacting, if the emergence of the classical world did not take place, physical intuition, as we use it in our reasoning, would break down. And in fact, perhaps it is the case that life could not have started or even be sustainable if not for, at the micro scale, things to be governed by quantum physics, and at the macro scale, the classical world emerges. And next on the menu, I'm going to switch paradoxes to something entirely different, and that's called quantum uncertainty. And this is a completely different experiment done with the same cat and the same ball. And in this type of miraculous contraption, the cartoon is meant to illustrate that the ball is able to drop down there and it can't go anywhere except out the funnels. Okay, and let's say that we arrange this in a sort of perfect way, where half the time, the ball's gonna bounce around and go down the left, and the other half of the time, well, down the right. And then we go on again and we ask our cat to conduct this experiment for us many times, and lo and behold, every single time, the cat sees just that. The ball either goes down the right, or the ball either goes down the left. Now, this is exactly what we'd expect. But let me tell it to you in a slightly different way. We have a result of a future event, and we look at the past. In the past, there was uncertainty. Okay, so there's uncertainty about the future, but then you have that result about the future. Do you have uncertainty about the past? Right. Although we can't be certain which of the funnels the classical ball will fall down, after we observe where it lands, we can retroactively reason as to what happened. We can use information about the present to understand what took place in the past. But I'll show you that in quantum physics, you can't always know the past, That's one of the things that makes it strange. So just to remind you that this is not quantum tunneling. The ball cannot tunnel. So we repeat this and we blindfold our cat so as not to disturb the outcomes of the experiment. We yet again release the ball, but this time it's a quantum particle. And it can't tunnel through. It has to go through the funnels. Okay? And we ask our cat, we say, do this experiment for us. And the cat finds that most of the time it lands in the middle. So that's strange. That's pretty strange, but that's strange. So we'll explain that, but then we'll say something even odder. So when you look at a quantum particle like a ball, you see it. It has physical shape. But when you don't look, it behaves like a wave. And in this particular case, it behaves like a wave and it travels through both the slits. Then the waves add and it lands in the middle. But that's not why I want to show you this. What can we say about the past if we have that information? What can we say about the past? We can know where the ball ended up, but not where it started or what its trajectory was. Not being able to know the past based on our current state of knowledge is a feature of quantum uncertainty. So although we're used to dealing with uncertainty in future events, we're not used to dealing with uncertainty about past events given all the information you need to construct a history. And that is why quantum physics is very strange. But it's going to get even stranger now. It's going to get very strange. So perhaps this is the most discomforting feature in all of physics, and that's quantum entanglement, which remotely links non-interacting matter. And I thought for a long time about how to explain this. And for the experts, to illustrate the essence, what I'm doing is I'm replacing a random choice of a measurement basis with a local coin toss. And for the rest of us, this will require two ingredients. The first ingredient is a pair of fair coins. On one side, of course, there's heads, and just as you'd expect, on the other side, tails. Okay, the second ingredient is a cat which is blindfolded and located in Helsinki. The cat rubs the quarters together to entangle them and drops them in the boxes. Then the boxes are closed and shipped. One goes here to Torino, and the other to Boston, and we have friends there. Here's where it gets a little bit tricky. We have to follow the rules, and so the rules of the game necessitate that the cat slips its paw into the box ever so gracefully, not to look, and it grabs a hold of the coin, and it flips that coin onto the floor. We record the outcome. Likewise, they do the same thing in Boston. At the end of the first day, we're so excited, we call our friends on the telephone. We call our friends, and we say, well, what happened? Okay, we have tails, you have heads. All right, well, what else happened? Nothing. What's so strange about this then? Okay, so what's going to happen now is our friend in Helsinki is going to keep shipping out these pairs of boxes with the entangled coins. And here we are in Torino. We're going to do this, let's say, for a month. And we're not going to talk to anyone in Boston. We're just going to keep doing this locally here in Torino. And they're going to keep doing it there in Boston. Okay? What's going to happen here? Here in Torino, heads shows up half the time and tails shows up the other. We record the first coin flip. Afterwards, we examine the coin. It's a fair coin. We're happy. For goodness sakes, we're being sent money. But it's not worth it, my friends. It's not worth it for what's going to occur. So what do you think will happen when we call our friends in Boston? Something so pathological it almost defies words. So what took place? We call them on the phone, just like that. And they pick up and they answer. And they tell us this. And it takes us just a moment to realize just how spooky this is. They're always opposite. But let me make it even stranger. And the more you think about this, the stranger it will become. Because here's the fact. We toss a coin here in Torino, and it lands tails. Therefore, we immediately conclude that in Boston they must have heads. Unfortunately, we cannot be sure if that is about the future or if that is about the past. We're certain what the outcome is, but we don't know if Boston got... We know that they got heads, but we don't know if it's about a future event or the past, so we're uncertain. But the fact of the matter is that first coin toss is completely random. And locally, all the coin tosses seem completely random, but we have to use that telephone to know if it's a future event or something that already took place. And that's quantum entanglement. It remotely links things. So to conclude, I'm going to go just one level. It's going to get a little bit worse now. So today we've said that quantum physics predicts the future, but quantum uncertainty bounds the accuracy of any prediction which could be made about the future or the past. And this is a consequence of the world we live in and is captured by quantum theory. Although there are probabilities, this does not mean our future is under our own control. Either you accept the laws of physics or think that your consciousness is fundamentally outside these laws. And you can't have one without the other, and you can't have both because they mutually contradict each other. And the trouble is, if you're governed by physics, then that's what you're governed by. And human beings, we don't like this. We don't like this idea. Perhaps it is because the very essence of our being relies on our ability to make choices and change the future for our own survival. So this contradicts us at the core of our instincts. And you complain to me again. You say, but wait, you just said that the future is fundamentally uncertain. And even quantum physics says that. You think that probabilities save the day, but they don't. However uncertain these probabilities might make my future unknown, these probabilities don't imply that I have free will, since I fundamentally cannot control them. And I must admit to you that I personally don't like this fact, but the universe does not care what I like. I can't accept it fully. I want to shape my destiny by choice. I truly would like to be more than a biological program where the computer's hardware's operating system is quantum physics. I want more than that. And I guess the whole point of this is, however uncertain probabilities ensure my future fate, these probabilities are not under my own control. Such probabilities are an inherent property of the fabric of space and matter interacting with time. Perhaps the only certainty I will ever know is that these probabilities govern my future unknown. And that right there, that is quantum certainty for the uncertain. Thank you very much.